We're so pleased that you could join us today, all of our students, community members, faculty, and staff. The 1620-2020 speaker series was originally conceived by Professor Thomas Doughton, and then a number of us came on board because we thought it was a great idea. And the idea of the series really is to explore past and contemporary relations between Native American and settler peoples in what is currently known as New England. The series looks at historic and ongoing Indigenous presence in conjunction with the 400th anniversary of the arrival of the Mayflower in Plymouth, Massachusetts, or the Wampanoag village of Patuxent. This is our third event in the series, and there are four total. It is entitled Massasoit's Meanings, Shifting Histories of Settler-Colonialism, leading up to our culminating event on November 7th, which is a screening of the film Pacachog, Where the River Bends. And this film is a walking tour that illuminates the Nipmuc history of the land on which Holy Cross is built. My name is Sarah Klotz, if you don't know me. I am Assistant Professor of English here at Holy Cross, and I'm also in charge of the Rhetoric and Composition minor. I am so pleased to introduce our two speakers today. We are really lucky to have two extraordinary historians joining us. Jean O'Brien of White Earth Ojibwe Ancestry is Distinguished McKnight University Professor of History at the University of Minnesota. She is the author of Monumental Mobility, The Memory Work of Massasoit with Lisa Blee, who's also joining us. This is, of course, what they will be talking about this evening. Her book, Firsting and Lasting, Writing Indians Out of Existence in New England, has had a particular impact on my own thinking about how settler colonial societies, such as the United States, use language, myth, and story to both enact and justify the dispossession of Indigenous peoples. She is a co-founder and past president of the Native American and Indigenous Studies Association, and inaugural co-editor with Robert Warrior of the Association's journal, Native American and Indigenous Studies. So thank you, Jean, so much for being with us tonight. Lisa Blee is Associate Professor of History at Wake Forest University. She is the author of Framing Chief Leshy, Narratives and the Politics of Historical Justice, which is a study of the trial of Chief Leshy, a Nisqually leader who was found guilty of murder by a jury of settlers and hanged in Washington Territory's first judicial execution. Framing Chief Leshy challenges readers to consider whether liberal legal structures can accommodate competing narratives and account for the legacies of colonialism to promote social justice today. She is also co-author of Monumental Mobility, which she'll be talking about today. Lisa teaches courses in the American West, Native American history, environmental thought, memory, and public history, and is the coordinator for the Cultural Heritage and Preservation Studies minor at Wake Forest. So thank you again to both of our speakers. I want to encourage our participants to note in the bottom of your Zoom screen, you should have a Q&A button. And really at any time during the talk, you can enter a question there. We're collecting the questions and we'll do our best to get to as many as we can after we hear from our speakers. So without further ado, let me hand it over to Jean and Lisa.
All right, thank you so much for having us. I'm going to start and Jean and I will kind of go back and forth and bring up the images now. All right, so among the remarkable events of this past summer in direct response to the murder of George Floyd was a resurgent activism in solidarity with the Black Lives Matter movement around monuments to white supremacy and colonialism. Protesters in sites around the UK forced a reckoning with statues and places named for wealthy slavers. Belgian protesters forced the city of Antwerp to remove a statue of King Leopold II. And in the United States, attention turned to statues glorifying Confederate generals, the Lost Cause, and racist oppression in dozens of communities. In Albuquerque in July, one protester was shot by an armed militiaman while denouncing a heroic statue of Juan de Oñate, the despotic colonial governor of New Mexico who brutalized Pueblo peoples. Police in riot gear broke up the gathering with tear gas and the statue was removed. Protesters in Richmond and St. Paul toppled statues of Christopher Columbus, seen here, and several other cities, including Columbus, Ohio, removed their statues preemptively. Richmond activist Chelsea Higgs Weiss announced, quote, "We have to start where it all began. We have to start with the people who stood first on this land." Protesters in Boston beheaded the Columbus statue, and Boston's mayor announced that it would be put in storage, followed by conversations about its historical meaning and its role in public display going forward. This was not the first time or place, nor the last, that monuments to Columbus have been targeted, as you may already have heard from Morgan Freeman and Thomas Doughton in the first program in the series. Now, across Indian country, attention has turned to removing symbols and names that celebrate colonialism and maintain indigenous oppression, from the removal of the racist name of Washington's NFL team to renaming a famous California ski resort. This moment carries a notable sense of urgency and momentum. Richmond Indigenous Society member Vanessa Bolin stated in July that she came to demand the removal of the Columbus statue, not to, quote, hijack the protests over police brutality, but rather to stand in solidarity. These and countless other anti-racism protests over monuments announce a dramatic resurgence of struggle over memorialization to white supremacy. And all of this spiked in the wake of the rally in Charlottesville in 2017 that resulted in the tragic death of Heather Heyer in the attack on anti-racism protesters. These events in Charlottesville unfolded just as we were finishing our book, Monumental Mobility, The Memory Work of Massasoit, that interrogates public memorials implicated in the politics of colonialism and appropriation. In the preface to our book, we pause to suggest that the vital public engagement with monuments to white supremacy ought to be placed in dialogue with the monumental scaffolding around settler colonialism and historical figures such as Columbus, which seem to be ramping up right now. Monumental Mobility is situated within the terrain of these intense debates over the placement, displacement, and replacement of monuments to difficult histories. So we take as our case study the statue Massasoit by sculptor Cyrus Dahlin, installed in Plymouth, Massachusetts in 1921 to commemorate the tercentenary of the landing of the Pilgrims. Dahlin's statue was intended to memorialize the Pokanoket Massasoit as a welcoming diplomat who negotiated the first treaty with the English. As well, the Massasoit was a participant in the mythical First Thanksgiving that stands at the center of American national origin stories. And brief note here, Massasoit is the Wampanoag word for leader. His actual name was Osamequin, meaning yellow feather. The statue was commissioned by the Improved Order of Redmen, which, if you have not heard of it before, is an all-white fraternal order hoping to demonstrate their patriotism through a bronze monument to Indians' purportedly peaceful embrace of the Pilgrims. But Massasoit, the statue, did not remain only in Plymouth. In our book, we trace the physical and narrative mobility of the Massasoit story through its inception and its movement in the guise of several unauthorized reproductions to numerous US locations through nefarious dealings in the fine art market to illuminate how the statue's attachment to national origins did and did not move with the installations. Taking as its point of departure the replication of an original statue with the status of fine art, our book examines its mobility from multiple angles. It analyzes the original inspiration for the monument, its design, installation in various locations, dedication ceremonies in diverse places over time, how to understand its reception by audiences, including indigenous ones, how it has and does figure in tourism, and importantly, how indigenous public intellectuals have intervened in historical narratives around settler colonialism read through the Massasoit statue, which is our focus today. What we found was that the meaning of the statue, along with the story of colonization and the founding of the nation it was commissioned to invoke, continues to evolve in Massachusetts and wherever the copies wound up. The force behind these changed meanings are twofold, through the work of indigenous intellectuals and the ways in which public history can reconfigure our relationship to the present through engagement with the past. The historical memory surrounding the Massasoit suggests the rich potential of indigenous public historians to intervene in sanitized national narratives of origins. Can the statue prompt viewers to reckon with the structural violence of settler colonialism in commemorative landscapes? Or rather, does it further entrench celebratory narratives of national origins? Our book is connected to that volatile debate, suggesting that monuments to settler colonialism ought to be part of the conversation about the place and meaning of historical monuments.
Indigenous interventions in New England public history have made steady inroads since the historic Day of Mourning protest in 1970 that came to be an annual event. These upended pilgrim-centered myths that have reverberated in the historic district of Plymouth and the surrounding area, including in connection with one of the town's storied historical institutions, Plymouth Plantation, which is now called Plymouth Pawtuxet. In our book, we turn to this living history venue and other New England public history sites and lots of other things to take up the work of Indigenous public intellectuals since the rupture of the inaugural Day of Mourning protest, including their connection to what was destined to be a fairly obscure 8-episode historical reality television series that was aired by PBS in 2004 called Colonial House. These very different and yet intertwined instances of public history, in addition to the memorial landscape in Wampanoag homelands, are all a form of time freezing, where guests and cast members and viewers, in the case of Colonial House, are prompted to strive to embody the past, a particular approach to closing historical distance and making visceral connections to the past. These sites also became places where Indigenous public intellectuals contested historical memory and forced direct engagement with the violence of settler colonialism in ongoing and dynamically reimagined ways. They also demonstrate the disjuncture between the impulse to freeze history, whether in 1621, the Massasoit Statute, 1627 or 1624, living history at Plymouth Plantation, depending on when you go there or went there, or 1628, reenacted in Colonial House, and the vital fact that Indigenous peoples are highly motivated to both embody this history and demonstrate in no uncertain terms that they are still a modern people looking to the future. We now want to focus on a particular mode of embodying history to close this distance between the present and the past that came in the form of Colonial House. The series website declares, "Think colonial life was all about pious pilgrims, powdered wigs, and freedom for all? Think again. 2 dozen modern day time travelers find out the hard way what early American colonial life was really like when they take up residence in Colonial House," unquote. The cast of men and women and children from the US and England arrive shipboard to an imaginary new world charged with building a profitable colony with only the technology of the time. Though set in 1621 coastal Maine on Passamaquoddy land, Colonial House is clearly about recreating the landing of the pilgrims in Plymouth and their struggle to build a colony complete with staged encounters with native peoples. This is a year after Plymouth Plantation's baseline year of interpretation of 1627, although they recently moved 3 years earlier to 1624. The parallels intended by the historical reality show are unmistakable, and it is no surprise that Plymouth Plantation played a leading role in shaping the series. It drew on expertise from its personnel in building the village where it is set, and they served as living history experts along with counterparts from England. Cast members spent 2 weeks at the plantation in intensive training in the technology, material culture, and attire of the time. Staff built the structures and furnished them on location, familiar tasks for them, but now imparted to people who would spend 4 months living the experience in a remote location for the cameras. Linda Coombs, Aquina Wampanoag, and Ramona Peters, Mashpee Wampanoag, joined John Bear Mitchell, Penobscot, and Donald Sucktama, Passamaquoddy, as consultants for the series. Coombs and Peters are highly visible Native intellectuals, and they appeared in one of the most powerful episodes in the series called The Reckoning, along with several Native people affiliated with Plymouth Plantation. It features a clan of Wampanoags traveling to visit relatives. In one of the most pointed exchanges inside the village, Wampanoag Nancy Eldridge chastises a fellow Native for accepting food from the colonists, which they all had agreed not to do. She sternly corrected him. "We just don't want it to appear like, you know, happy Indians with the first Thanksgiving, because it wasn't like that at all. And if we were being treated in a good way even today, and our land wasn't still being taken, and we weren't still being thought of as unintelligent savages, then, you know, I would say fine," unquote. Following this tense exchange, the voiceover informs the viewer, relations between the colonists and Native Americans are romanticized in the traditional Thanksgiving story. It's commonly thought that in 1621, the Wampanoag joined the colonists in a friendly 3-day feast, unquote. Ramona Peters points out, "We know that wouldn't have been the case," unquote. The would-be colonists acknowledge that that must be right. The voiceover adds details Peters herself has highlighted to underscore her point. The real story is that 90 Wampanoag men showed up after hearing gunfire. Instead of war, they found the Plymouth colonists preparing for a feast. In the interest of diplomacy, the Wampanoag joined in, but the event was never to be repeated, unquote, and subsequently informs the viewer about the day of mourning that has been held on Thanksgiving Day in Plymouth ever since 1970. This scene sets up one of the most soul-searching moments in the whole series. At a solemn meal in the evening, the colonists process their day. Paul Hunt, an Englishman who portrayed a servant in the series, laments, "She kept mentioning the English and looking at me in particular, and she said, 'You guys, the English, you came over here and you did this and you did that.' If she said your ancestors, it would be one scenario. I just found that quite offensive," unquote. Carolyn Hines, who was at that time preparing the governor's wife, retorted that, "Your society was the imperial power that colonized for 300 years, half the world. So if it does, if you got a little bit of discomfort about it, it probably does you a bit of good too. Nobody really likes to have it pointed out that your people and your culture have been responsible for their suffering. We need to have it pointed out though," unquote. Another press participant assents. Carolyn continues, "It suddenly sunk in a way that it hadn't up until then, that I'm going along with being an imperialist." Some murmur in assent. She adds, "It didn't really sink in on me that I'm reenacting a whole system that I don't believe in and I disapprove of, yet it's the roots of our nation, who we are," unquote. The group continues to contemplate, and not for the first or the last time in the series, Caroline gets the final say. She reflects that being troubled over the US and the context of the world by calculation post 9/11 prompted her to participate in the project. "I thought how good it might be to go back and to relive an earlier, simpler, purer point in our national history. So here I am, and of course what I'm discovering is there was no pure moment in our history, international history. This is not a pure moment. We were already moving in. We were already driven by greed and ambition, and we were willing to shove away the native people. So what is better then than now? Sniffles are audible. I don't know," unquote. The episode closes with silent contemplation over a fire. From the first episode, the intent of Native consultants and participants to confront efforts to freeze them in a sanitized past was revealed when Mitchell announced to the cast members, "We have been through the largest genocide, the largest Holocaust on the soil of the United States. We are recipients of all that death, and the Holocaust that happened on this soil was one of embarrassment for this country," unquote. The reckoning brings this indigenous perspective into bold relief with the buildup to the confrontation in the village. The narrator foreshadows the action in the episode by announcing the natives are prepared to confront settlers over the issue of colonization. Over the course of several scenes, the argument unfolds. Akwina Wampanoag Jonathan Perry points out, "Being here is a chance to represent our people, to show that we are a continuing culture and a continuing people, a modern people, as well as having deep roots with our ancestors, and to have our story told," unquote. In the same scene, Eldridge justifies indigenous anger as legitimate, quote, "especially when it seems like America in general doesn't like our history to be told," unquote. Mashpialis Lopez illustrates the ongoing impact of the structure of settler colonialism by insisting Indian land is still being taken all over the country, and as long as you don't acknowledge Native people, then you don't have to acknowledge that you're doing anything wrong to anyone," unquote. The reckoning represents a crescendo in the collision of historical narratives about origins and a powerful rejection of frozen narratives that refuse to explain the origins and still reverberating consequences of the United States as a settler colonial nation.
Well, the Quirky Colonial House Project constituted a one-time media intervention that was largely ignored. Indigenous public intellectuals take up the work of overturning mythological ideas about history in the town of Plymouth on a daily basis. The memorial landscape in Plymouth, including the Massasoit statue, helps those who traverse it to make meaning of New England's and the nation's history. And as you well know, if you were able to view the previous program on Wampanoag life before the Pilgrims with Linda Coombs and Kelly Wisecup, the town of Plymouth was built directly atop the 1,000-year-old village of Patuxet, a thriving community with an estimated population of 2,000 in the first decades of the 1600s. Villagers were in occasional contact with Europeans set on trading, slaving, or plundering along the coast. But starting in 1616, Patuxet was hit hard by waves of epidemics. When the Mayflower dropped anchor in the bay in 1620, the English colonists would have seen a village only recently evacuated as the survivors sought refuge elsewhere. When English colonists erected shelters amidst the existing houses and grave sites, they claimed the renamed place in honor of the home they left behind. Nearly half of the Mayflower passengers died that first winter. They were buried in a mass grave near the waterfront, now called Coles Hill, upon which a commemorative statue of the Wampanoag leader was erected 300 years later. This is a story about a place undergoing terrible suffering and loss. Yet the Massasoit statue and the Thanksgiving myth that later attached to this place cast a positive glow. This is a place composed of welcoming Indians and well-meaning pilgrims, making Plymouth into the birthplace of the nation. It is the story of peaceful colonization that the Improved Order of Redmen hope to celebrate and cast in bronze. A tourist to Plymouth today can easily access the pilgrim-centered story as we did on our research trips. By gazing upon a diminutive rock we were instructed to venerate, taking a tour with a pilgrim-clad guide who insists the Patuxets gave away their land because they no longer wanted it, not true. By listening to a visitor center volunteer explain that all of the native residents had died off, and we actually heard them say this. And by perusing the town's gift shops stuffed with depictions of happy pilgrims and Indians sharing a feast. The memorial landscape and dominant narratives of its history insist on maintaining a cognitive distance from the past that insulates visitors from uncomfortable truths, even as they purport to bring viewers closer to history by connecting them to hallowed ground. Yet as we arrive upon the 400th anniversary of the Mayflower's contact with Patuxet, Wampanoag and other indigenous public intellectuals have brought new energy to their engagement with this landscape to craft a more complicated and coherent depiction of New England's past. Unlike most of the memorial landscape in Plymouth, which freezes the town as an English place, these educators create ways to introduce visitors to long excluded experiences and perspectives. Up until 2020, tourists could join Tim Turner on his native Plymouth tours, where Patuxet becomes visible and the crowded memorial landscape on the waterfront can be reevaluated from an indigenous perspective. They can also visit museums, libraries, and Plymouth plantation programs that offer guidance and instruction in Wampanoag experiences in the 17th century and today. Visitors may feel discomfort that comes with new awareness of a more complex reality and history, but such an experience with historical memory does the work of closing the cognitive distance between the past and the present. How and why do Indigenous intellectuals engage in this difficult public-facing work? The Indigenous public intellectuals we engage with in Plymouth are part of a progressive movement that insists Native people must be heard and have a role in shaping public understanding of the region's history. They are building upon the foundation of the Day of Mourning gathering, which we see as vitally important. The gathering began in response to an attempt to censor and exclude Indigenous voices. In 1970, the town of Plymouth invited Wampanoag activist Wamsutta Frank James, depicted here, to speak at an event marking the 350th anniversary of the Mayflower's landing. But upon reviewing James's planned remarks, the event organizers deemed his speech insufficiently celebratory and provided James with a speech of their own, which James refused to read, prompting the organizers to uninvite him. James made his way to Massasoit, the statue, and read his speech in protest to a gathering of fewer than a dozen people. "This is a time of celebration for you," he said, "but it is with a heavy heart that I look back upon what happened to my people. Massasoit and his people welcomed and befriended the settlers of Plymouth Plantation. This action by Massasoit was perhaps our biggest mistake." James organized the activist group United American Indians of New England following this incident, and they have held a national day of mourning at the statue on Thanksgiving Day ever since. As a young activist, Mashpee Wampanoag Paula Peters delighted in the Day of Mourning gatherings in Plymouth. And now, as we approach another anniversary of the Mayflower landing, Peters has led a Wampanoag team of designers, researchers, and interpreters in the creation of a traveling exhibit titled Our Story, 400 Years of Wampanoag History, aimed at non-Indian audiences. Peters and her team produced and toured exhibit panels starting in 2014 with the intention of adding panels every year up to 2020. The first panel, titled Captured 1614, presents the Wampanoag perspective on the slaving expedition of Englishman Thomas Hunt, who seized 27 men and boys from Patuxet and Nauset. Peters explained in a press release, quote, "This is a critical piece of the history of Plymouth that can't be told accurately without a Wampanoag voice." Indeed, how else to explain initial distrust of the Mayflower passengers and how Tisquantum, also known as Squanto, one of the men abducted in 1614 and returned home 5 years later, had learned enough English to greet the colonists. Another panel, The Great Dying, takes up the epidemic that wreaked such destruction starting in 1616. In addition to chronicling and contextualizing these historical events with straightforward text, the exhibit also includes a series of videos that pack a real emotional punch, and these are all on YouTube. I encourage people to look it up. In a reenactment of the 1614 abduction, young Wampanoag men struggle against English captors on the beach, then sit bound and terrified in the ship's hull. In several clips, Wampanoag people, dressed in fur mantles and deerskin, relate the experience of suddenly losing husbands, brothers, sons, fathers. In one clip, Ntana Hicks Greendeer, wonders about the savagery of people who would snatch men from their families, and imagines how her children will suffer without their father. Viewers watching these videos witness speakers dressed in period clothing expressing real emotions of grief. Peters told us that she didn't direct speakers to act in any prescribed fashion. She simply told them the facts and asked them to imagine themselves in such a situation. The Wampanoag interpreters modeled for viewers how to close the distance between the past and the present to access both the emotional impact of a disorienting loss and the experiences of those who lived with the knowledge of this history as part of their contemporary identities. We see these difficult histories as presented in this and other Our Story panels to be impactful for a number of reasons. First, the deeply researched exhibit engages viewers with themes of trauma and colonial violence in a deliberately non-confrontational manner. That is, the events are placed in their historical context, but the colonial legacies and evidence of Indigenous resilience are made accessible today as well. As Peters reflected on the positive public response to the exhibit and its intention to prompt viewers to question comforting narratives, she asserted the truth, quote, had to be told to them in a way that made them think. The second way in which this presentation, the exhibit, is impactful is that the panels provide important context for understanding the place that the Mayflower passengers encountered in 1620 and the upheavals and crises that explain Osamequin's decision to forge an alliance with the colonists. The feel-good story of Indigenous acquiescence no longer makes sense when the story starts in 1614 and includes their perspectives. It is disrupting the teleological narrative upon which the quadricentennial is based. Which events matter to the identity of the nation, and who has the power to choose anniversaries worthy of commemoration? This is an ingenious way to contribute to the Plymouth 400-year anniversary programming, while also destabilizing its implied chronology and subverting its inherent narrative. The exhibit designers are both enlarging the historical consciousness of America's shared past and disrupting the assumption that history begins when the colonizers set foot on the shore. Their interventions prompt visitors to wonder, what if we freeze a moment in 1614, 1616, 1619, or even 1970, and take a look around? What kind of world do we find? And what can such time travel teach us about contingency, resilience, and our capacity for change? We see Massasoit, the statue, as an important touchstone in public history that sets up a complex push and pull dynamic around the problem of historical memory. The Improved Order of Redmen erected it as a manifestation of their historical distancing from the violence of the colonial encounter. And yet, as with all monuments, meaning comes from engagement with the statue and the story it is intended to fix in bronze. So our book asks, how effective has the Redmen's project been in the long run? What is the place of the Massasoit in time, in space, and in narratives of the nation? Does the statue secure the distance intended by the Redmen in the historical memory of this imagined foundational moment? What meaning do people make of the history in those distant locations where casts of Massasoit came to be mounted? Salt Lake City, Provo, Kansas City, Chicago, Spokane, Dayton. To what extent do observers hold on to the historical distancing implicit in the narrative of the Massasoit that so profoundly elides the violence of settler colonialism? What we found illustrates how multivalent historical meaning-making can be in divergent places. This particular set of monuments to the Massasoit open a fascinating window into the process of historical memory formation, or the crucial work that physical location and cognitive distance perform in historical memory. In these public history locations, Indigenous people insist on a reckoning with the past and the present that refuses narratives of frozen Indians in a place sanitized of the violence and trauma of settler colonialism. In all of these locations, historical memory is contested rather than resolved for once and for all. Historical meaning-making is revealed as dynamic, interactive, unsettled, open to interpretation. Indigenous people use the statue as well as locations of living history to explain settler colonialism as a structure, Indigenous dispossession set loose at that moment and continuing as a system of oppression, rather than as an event, such as the peace treaty or the Mutual Defense Alliance. In these senses, Massasoit opens a window not just on how to think about the distance between the historical moment and the present, but also the distance between the very different non-Indian and Indigenous projects of commemoration. For Indigenous peoples, there's a double distancing operating: the distance between the memorialized moment and now, and the distance between Native and non-Indian willingness to embrace uncomfortable histories. They refuse to be frozen in this narrative, but instead insist that the past be reckoned with in a way that includes their perspective on history and the ongoing ramifications of their lives under settler colonialism. Imagined from these multiple vantage points, Massasoit finds a place in highly mobile interpretive terrain that unsettles rather than fixes historical narratives in bronze and stone. So to return to the National Day of Mourning, this event was born in response to a significant anniversary in settler memory, yet it set in motion an alternative timeline that emphasizes Indigenous resilience throughout a shared past. In 1970, Wampanoag activist Wamsutta Frank James was disinvited from speaking because of his interpretation of the event. In response, he initiated a new timeline of Wampanoag protest and visibility, one that would be observed from that point forward in calendrical time. The next year, under the leadership of Wampanoag activists Tall Oak and Brian Miles, Plymouth Plantation established the Wampanoag program to be staffed by Native people. Linda Coombs recalled that establishing the program, which allowed visitors for the first time to, quote, hear our story from our perspective, was a knockdown, drag-out fight. But it was initiated as a direct result of the first National Day of Mourning. It created the opportunity for generations of Wampanoag and other Native employees to conduct intensive research into the 17th century world and learn skills and techniques their ancestors had mastered. Coombs noted that when visitors were directed to the Wampanoag home site before entering the English village beginning in the late 1990s, quote, that just flipped the whole script. Visitors released their reverence for the colonists and rather demanded to know why the English stole Indian land. The effect was noticeable, Coombs recalled.
The long-term impacts of the Day of Mourning can be seen in other ways as well. The annual Day of Mourning protests picked up urgency and attracted more militant activists in the 1990s. Marches through the city provoked fear of disorder that the town of Plymouth was anxious to quell. One significant result of negotiations between Plymouth and the United American Indians of New England was the installation of a plaque with an explanation of the Day of Mourning placed beside Massasoit. If our interviews with passersby in Plymouth are any indication, local residents and tourists alike have taken note of the plaque, and many have reflected on the alternative narrative, Thanksgiving, and the settler colonialism it explains. It was evidence in stone and metal that colonists did not disembark in the wilderness, that Indigenous people did not give away their land and then dutifully die off. For those paying attention to the plaque, the story of peaceful colonization stopped making sense. Ever since its installation, visitors moved by the plaque's words have taken this more complicated narrative home with them. The annual Day of Mourning protests and the plaque beside the statue change interpretations of Massasoit and disrupt the ritualized Thanksgiving and mythology in Plymouth. And yet, as such episodes enter the larger stage of public debate, they suggest that a reckoning with a violent and conflicted past still reverberating in the present is an ever larger element of public consciousness. As the mythologized origins of the nation and Anglo-settler colonial memory, Plymouth is a crucial site for disrupting the dominant narrative of Indian acquiescence and disappearance at the root of so many other memorial controversies across the US and elsewhere. On the occasion of the 400th anniversary of the Pilgrim's Landing, Wampanoags see an opportunity to teach people about the complexities of colonial history and foster an alternative temporal consciousness. Similar to the creation of the Wampanoag program at Plymouth Plantation, the Plymouth 400 Board, tasked with planning commemorative events for 2020, was formed in response to Indigenous protest. Linda Coombs recalled how the board invited Wampanoag perspectives, quote, because they really do not want to do what they did 100 years ago when white residents performed as Wampanoags in a pageant and Massasoit was installed on Coles Hill, or have another whole nother Frank James thing like in 1970, unquote. Wampanoag involvement in the Plymouth 400 has resulted in the temporal reconfiguration of settler memory in two really interesting ways, we think. The first is to insist upon James' 1970 Speech Act as year zero of Wampanoag perspectives on the American origin story that will no longer be ignored or silenced in connection to settler colonialism. 2020, in this alternate timeline, represents the 50th year anniversary of the creation of the Day of Mourning, rather than the 400th anniversary of a different event. The Our Story exhibit hits this point home with its final exhibit panel to be released this year, which focuses on the Day of Mourning gathering. If anniversaries help us to recall and ritualize memories in calendrical time, Wampanoags insist upon an acknowledgement of additional events and a shared history between Indigenous peoples and non-natives. we want to underscore how important this visibility is to New England Indians who still struggle mightily to have the general public acknowledge their existence and ongoing sovereignty at all. The second way in which Wampanoag elders and teachers have crafted a new historical consciousness around the Plymouth 400th anniversary is by starting the Our Story exhibit in 1614 with a traumatic abduction. They insist upon moving the timeline back 6 years to more fully contextualize English Wampanoag relations when the Mayflower Pilgrims founded their colony on the bay. This kidnapping and the epidemics that followed soon after form, quote, a critical backstory to colonization in the roots of the American holiday, Thanksgiving, unquote. From the Wampanoag perspective, the agreement of mutual defense that Osamequan famously negotiated with the English can only make sense by taking into account the ways in which the slaving expedition and the academics devastated their ancestors, threatened their understanding of the entire cosmos, and weakened the Wampanoag nation politically and militarily in the years immediately prior to the Pilgrims' arrival. Wampanoag educators have responded to the settler colonial narrative, particularly the myth of peaceful first contact and Thanksgiving, rather than exclusively crafting their own separate history in public protests, plaques, performances, and exhibits. They are, in other words, engaging. They thus illustrate the creative potential of directly confronting a deeply painful history of settler colonialism. While the disruptions to settler memory may focus on undoing myths, challenging narratives of disappearance, and especially addressing anniversaries of the peaceful founding of the nation, Wampanoag historical interventions have been generative and creative rather than simply passive or reactionary. The decades of work of Indigenous people that has gone into flipping the script on this history in Plymouth reverberate out, illustrating how memorial interventions can foster dialogue about the legacies of settler colonialism far from the New England coast. In spring 27, a protest erupted in Minneapolis, where I am right now, over a controversial interactive sculpture called Scaffold installed in the Walker Art Center's sculpture garden. The white multimedia artist of the piece, Sam Durant, who had grown up near Plymouth, intended his work to represent the gallows used in executions of political dissidents, freedom fighters, and Native Americans, specifically the 38 Dakota men hanged in Mankato, Minnesota, after the devastating U.S. Dakota War in 1862 to explore issues of inequality, race, and state violence in U.S. history. The design of the scaffold was based on the heinous device built specifically to hang all 38 Dakota warriors simultaneously. But Dakota protesters argued the artwork trivialized a traumatic event in their history. Viewers could walk on and off the scaffold without having to grapple with the deep pain the executions inflicted in the region. Quote, this is a murder machine that killed our people because we were hungry, unquote, said Sam Wounded Knee, Crow Creek, Dakota. Durant listened to Dakota elders and agreed to remove the piece and sign over the intellectual rights to the Dakota Nation. As he recalled from the conversations, quote, the Dakota people basically saw something that looked like a monument to their massacre, unquote. Durant admitted that he had not understood the local context, which included the fact that state history textbooks had only acknowledged the forced removal of the Dakota people in 2015. The legislature had decided over the protest of Native citizens not to relocate most of the artworks in the state's Capitol Senate chambers, glorifying cultural and racial superiority over the Dakota Nation. And a controversy had arisen over how to commemorate the bicentennial of a military fort built on a site of Dakota spiritual significance that served as an internment camp for Dakota men, women, and children and elders after the Mankato execution. Although the details of the local history are specific to the region and the Dakota Nation, such controversies over the persistence of settler memory in public spaces, halls of government, commemorations, and historical narratives can be found across the United States and elsewhere. As he reflected on his evolving awareness of the presence of the colonial past in the present, Durant recalled witnessing a protest on Plymouth Rock in the early 1970s when he was quite young. Quote, it was United American Indians of New England. They were saying, hey, America, this is a catastrophe for us, not a celebration. It's a day of mourning, unquote, of that quote. I remember thinking, oh, there's another side to this, he said, unquote. As he saw in Plymouth and belatedly learned in Minneapolis, acknowledging that the nation has been built on dispossession and violence involves an uncomfortable dialogue about the structure of power that continues to shape collective memory in place and in time and everywhere, really. Durant's failure to anticipate the heart-wrenching responses of Dakota people illustrates the power of settler memory to isolate and expunge heinous moments of violence while leaving antiseptic national narratives intact. For Durant, in this particular moment, colonialism was effectively a singular event rather than a structure, underscoring the power of settler colonialism to erase its ubiquitous polarizing of indigenous peoples, places, and rights. So it's not so straightforward. Indigenous people have taken on the task of reframing Massasoit, the statue, and placing the story of what they interpret as the sachem's mutual defense agreement within a larger context of indigenous suffering, survival, and resilience. The monument thus serves as a site of intervention, an opportunity to disrupt settler memory and install an alternative temporal consciousness. Wampanoag people have held a national day of mourning of protest at the site of the statue since 1970 as a way to embody counter-narratives to Thanksgiving Day celebrations that violate Indigenous understandings of settler colonialism rooted so particularly in Plymouth. A revisionist marker installed next to Massasoit addresses the violence unleashed upon Indigenous people after the English arrived, effectively closing the cognitive distance between Osumiquin's time and our own. With these interventions, a space can open up for reconsideration of history and identity, and viewers have the opportunity to grapple with discomfort and new forms of memory. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that really enlightening talk. I want to encourage our participants to start using the Q&A button to give some questions to our speakers who we have with us for maybe 20 more minutes or as many as 30, depending on how many questions we get. While those Q&As are coming in, I wanted to ask a couple of questions just to get us going. And the first one was, I really love the language that you use to describe what memorialization is or can be. You use language like the freezing of history, the sanitizing of history, and you opened with such a provocative statement, which is that a lot of these monuments are memorializing white supremacy. So I'm wondering if you could speak to what white supremacy has to do with the freezing of history and the sanitizing of history. Like, what is the connection and the investment of white supremacy in these particular kinds of storytelling?
Lisa, go ahead.
I was gonna say the same thing, Ginny. Okay, well, freezing time is an incredible opportunity to edit, right? So that I think is the best way to maintain, I guess, white supremacy is to be able to have the power to edit out and pick and choose, right? What exactly from one particular moment you want to have or always see in that space, right? So you can erase the layers of history, generations of lives, right? And freeze it in a moment that when edited down to one kernel of a narrative provides a sense that white supremacy is unchallenged, fundamentally good, and inevitable.
Lisa, I've never heard you in all these years we've worked on this project and talked about it. I never heard you talk about it quite that way. That's really powerful. Oh. It really, I mean, the idea of editing through the choice of a moment is, I guess it's implicitly what we're arguing in this book, but we never use quite exactly that language. And, you know, it is all about historical narratives is all about editing. If you think about it that way, what the author of a textbook, for example, chooses to feature in it is a choice, and it involves exclusion. So excluding stories, right? We know that, mm-hmm. But to think about it as editing, I think is really powerful. I mean, and it does uphold white supremacy, as we call it today. I mean, I think the improved order of red men at the time would have thought of it as, you know, the Christian origins of the nation, given their cultural blinders, but they are performing all kinds of editing out, including, as we talk about in the book, the editing out of Indigenous voices they know are there at the time that are featured even in the unveiling ceremonies. So that's power in operation, and it takes different forms over time. And these statues, as we argue in the book, are constantly being reevaluated based on the history that's happened and the people who are engaging with them and how they're engaging with them.
Right. I think that having a monument to a process, like the Day of Mourning monument does, it takes away that, I guess, the power of freezing, right? Of taking a, or editing one moment for inclusion or others for exclusion. You don't have that power anymore if you see an ongoing process.
And this is something we've talked about a lot, because we did interviews at each of the locations of the statues that where they all are, with a number of things that we wanted to learn from passersby. And it was really about our overarching question about what does it mean to engage with monuments? And how is that as an individual and collective experience? And we found that the people who bothered to walk up the stairs to Coles Hill and read that monument thought twice about what they were looking at and what that history represented. So we found a kind of power in that counterside, at least at this monument. Mm-hmm. We're not so sure about others.
Yeah.
Great, thank you so much. Let me ask you one more question. I wanna focus on this idea of the Thanksgiving story as it's mythologized in the culture, the textbooks, the rituals of the United States. And I can certainly speak from a settler perspective myself, there's a real emotional investment in the story of Thanksgiving. Mm-hmm. And this, you know, we get days off and we're with family and there's special foods and there's so much emotional investment in this false narrative. Yeah. And it makes me think about last week we were talking about mascots and how mascots represent very damaging stereotypes. But because they're attached to a team, they also generate this emotional investment in that stereotype among the fans. And then the fans take it as a personal affront to hear this is damaging to a group of people. It should not be a mascot. So this is a question about nation building and stories, narratives. What do we do with these emotional investments in false narratives that create, they're very powerful, I think, because of that. And I'm wondering how Indigenous intellectuals and public historians that you're talking about, how have they found ways to intervene in these powerful emotional stories?
Mm-hmm. You know, I can't answer the precise end part of your question. I don't think we really asked anybody about that, how they're intervening in the story about Thanksgiving. But I mean, where I would start, and I think that you have to have a complicated answer to that question. It's a complicated problem. I would start by editing out the playing Thanksgiving pageantry in schools that still happens in really terrible ways. And that, you know, we, in our research, actually based on secondary research, James Baker from Plymouth Plantation wrote a book on Thanksgiving that we use a lot. That whole idea doesn't really come into common circulation until the very end of the 19th century and the early 20th century, and it's about Americanization of immigrants. Right? So that is not an old myth or an old story that people would have to shake up, or it's not that old. It's not as old as Plymouth, right? So there's that on the one hand. And then there's the holiday itself. So I gave a talk on our book for Thanksgiving at the Mill City Museum in Minneapolis last fall. And one of my neighbors came to it. I really, really like her a lot. And she came up to me afterwards and she said, "Oh my gosh, I love Thanksgiving. Does this mean I have to give it up?" And I said, "No, that is not what we're saying about Thanksgiving. I love Thanksgiving too. It's like our biggest family holiday." And most Native peoples who I know, that's the case as well. And so I think we can separate out that celebration of, you know, which should be the harvest, which isn't happening in November anyway. It's really about the Christmas shopping season, let's be honest. Well, you know, Thanksgiving Day in Canada is in what we call here in Minneapolis now Indigenous Peoples Day, which is closer to harvest time, right? if it's going to be a harvest festival. So Thanksgiving's a complicated thing, and I don't think we should get rid of it. But I think I do think we should complicate it and think hard about, you know, those late 19th century, early 20th century narratives that it still carries, because that's not something we need. And, you know, I would just say for mascots, we've got the Washington football team now taking on a new name. I have long said about that, that you can tell that that's not really about honoring Native people, because rebranding that franchise is going to be real lucrative for them. So people are going to need to deal with it, is what I would say is my answer to that.
Yeah. And I don't have much to add to Jeannie's answer, but I have been in conversations with people at a local museum about whether to give a presentation about this book to the museum membership. And one of the concerns is that it's a downer right at Thanksgiving, right? And I kind of don't get it, because I think the power of the Day of Mourning March and celebrate, it's not a celebration, the Day of Mourning March is also a celebration of survival, given the incredible violence of settler colonialism and what was unleashed 400 years ago. So it's kind of a matter of what we choose to see as worthy of celebration, right? What if we decide to, rather than celebrating this mythical meal, what we're celebrating is our capacity to overcome incredible challenges, our capacity to understand ourselves better by being truthful about who we are, right? Like, I think there's actually a lot of potential to continue to celebrate together, but in a way that is true to history too.
And this goes to that idea of 1970 as year zero of Wampanoag interpretation, which is Lisa's insight. And I'm like, yes, oh God, yes, exactly. Right, this is this moment where everything is different. And it's not going to get, the hands of time are not going to get turned back. A moment of Indigenous people declaring their power to narrate. And that has only continued to blossom and proliferate in really wonderful ways. So I think that's the right way to put it, Lisa. It's a positive development.
Yeah, I mean, what if we, as settlers, kind of free ourselves of the ambiguity and just kind of live in truth a little bit. You know, I think that does not have to be a downer.
So you're both reminding me, my research is on the Carlisle Indian Industrial School, which is, for those who don't know, the first off-reservation boarding school where many young Indigenous people, at first from the Southern Plains and then from many, many regions, were sent to be forced to learn English, forget their cultures, assimilate into the society of the United States. And in the end of the 19th century, just like you were saying, Jean, they started doing Thanksgiving pageants where these Indigenous students were performing roles of the pilgrims and the Indians and having this sit down meal together. So it was almost like part of their assimilation process was to embrace this new narrative of Thanksgiving that was emerging. So you just reminded me of that part of my research that I think is fascinating, troubling, really speaks to what this myth is doing and how you have to participate in this myth on some level to consider yourself a citizen of the United States. Mm-hmm. So we have many questions from the audience. So I wanna go ahead and turn it over and I'll start sending them your way. This is from Sarah Luria, who is my co-panelist. She says, how important is it to view and believe US land today as stolen? And are there strategies you can imagine to gain acceptance of that view? Perhaps the Our Story exhibit models some ways.
That's a hard question. I'll give it a first stab and then Lisa can maybe jump in. So I have noticed in the last, I'm gonna say 4 years or so, a real transformation in my students in my classroom. And it really has ramped up this year with the summer that we've been through. And, you know, everything that has happened, including the protests and demonstrations that really took off after the murder of George Floyd right here in Minneapolis. So it has a very very local valence, but I think it reverberates out everywhere from what I'm understanding. My students, including, we have this great program here at the University of Minnesota where retired people can take our classes for $10. So I always have a few folks who are my age or older, and that's always wonderful. The appetite for hearing and learning about this story has never been more voracious. And they actually want to talk about words that we couldn't really use in our classrooms even a few years ago because it would turn people's minds, like genocide. They use that word, they bring it up. I mean, I teach it as well, but people are angry about a narrative that has been handed to them that does not ever account for the complexity of indigenous peoples on this continent. And they're mad. How can they not, how can it be that they get to college in a place like Minnesota where you cannot deny there are native people everywhere? How can that story not be taught them? So they want to know, and yeah, I'll leave it there. It's, things are changing. I think the world is changing under our feet in ways that I would don't think many of us foresaw.
Yeah, I can see locally across universities too, there's new interest in writing and promoting the land acknowledgements, right? Before university-sponsored programs. I'm not exactly sure how that works in our Zoom world now, but I'm starting to see that, you know, at my university, which in some ways is pretty conservative and insular. And that I think makes a difference. Hearing those land acknowledgments over and over again, it makes a difference.
Yeah, and I don't know if people have followed this, but there was an amazing news story that was published in High Country News this summer called Land Grab Universities, which I will highly recommend, where a journalist and a historian by the name of Bobby Lee, who teaches at the University of Cambridge, reconstructed virtually every acre of land that went to build the land grant university system and where it came from and who benefited from it and how much money it raised and in some cases is still raising for universities. And, you know, the surprising fact that in a place like Massachusetts, it turns out that MIT is the land grant in Massachusetts. I highly recommend it. It's already having an impact on universities. For example, Cornell, which actually is the biggest recipient of all of the land grant universities, has established, I don't know what they're calling it, a committee to try to think about what they can do for some kind of restitution. We'll, I think, be doing that here at Minnesota. We have a new director of tribal relations, a native lawyer, who's very involved in all kinds of initiatives. So I think, you know, there's a big conversation about land acknowledgements and what they do and do not do. I think we're at the point where we need to do more than that. I think more and more institutions are understanding and agreeing with that sentiment. We have an interesting example of it at Minnesota that's been around for a long time. One of our campuses is in Morris, Minnesota. It's basically our liberal arts campus, and it's smallish, and it's built on the site of two former residential Indians residential schools. And for a long, long time there, tuition for Indigenous students and First Nation students has been free because of that. And as a consequence, the student population there is 25% Indigenous. So there are things that can be done.
Thank you. Let me send another question your way. This is from David. He has a question about Massasoit's role as a diplomat and a leader. He says, given this history, was Massasoit wrong to have welcomed an alliance with the Pilgrims? How should that story be told?
I'll start, Lisa, you can jump in. So in our conversations with Native people in New England, we got different stories about that. We got he's controversial in our communities because of what happened, but how could he have known? What was he trying to do? How could he have possibly understood what he was trying to accomplish at the time? how could he have known what was to come? And, you know, here he is in a geopolitical world that's been transformed by epidemics where they were hit hard, but the powerful Narragansett just across the bay were not. And so they're trying to think about how to be strategic about maintaining their own geopolitical power in the region. So it's complicated. I mean, of course, hindsight is 2020 and all that. Well, I'll start there.
Yeah. I'm thinking about the Plymouth plantation programs, right? Where they really try to get guests, visitors, to put themselves in, I guess, the Massasoit's shoes, right? And given what he could know at that point, and we can't expect people to know what's going to happen in the future, right? So based on what's happening, based on what you know, what could you do differently, right? Mm-hmm. And another thing I find really interesting, along with the kind of the question of we don't have to celebrate what he did. We can celebrate sort of the office of the leader. But there's also a bit of questioning about whether Osamequin was as powerful and influential as the English claim. Mm-hmm. And I won't go as far as to say a sort of a disavowal, but an acknowledgement that Osamequin may not have had the influence over other communities. They didn't go along with what he wanted. So his one decision may not have been as important as we now think it was.
Yeah, there are leaders in the other 68 villages. And also, you know, they from early on, Europeans and then the Americans, people in the US, they wanted singular leaders who wielded a lot of power over all of the people. And that just isn't how it worked. So it's complicated, as always.
So this is a question from my colleague, Colin Novick, who is working with us on our project to make this film about our hill where Holy Cross is. As you review the different approaches to monuments, Massasoit, the gallows, et cetera, do you feel we are best directed to take down the Columbus statues as a false narrative needing erasure? Or do we leave them up and reinterpret them and use them as a touch point for a counter narrative going forward?
So that's hard. We always get that question or version of it, and we still can't like jump off the top of our tongues and just answer it. Yeah. I always like the way Lisa starts. Lisa, you usually start by saying, well, you have to talk to the people where the statue is.
Yeah, I mean, our research showed that the Massasoit statue had different meanings in the different places where it was installed. And even in places where it made no sense, right, in Salt Lake City, it still meant something to Dene or to Ute people who happened to go to the state capital in Utah and see an indigenous form, mm-hmm. right, and so close to the halls of power, right? So I think it's a question of which statue and where and what it means to people there.
But to take the Columbus statues that have come down or are a matter of debate at this moment, let's take three examples: St. Paul, Minnesota, Chicago, and Columbus, Ohio, right? I mean, so Columbus, Ohio decided to take it down. And I think they're gonna decide what to do with it. They've got a little bit more complicated problem than St. Paul does. Where St. Paul's not named after Columbus, after all.
But right? I just reread this chapter from Trio, and he looks into Columbus, Ohio, and can't actually find where the city was named after Columbus.
Oh, is that right?
The figure. But it's become tied together over time. Yeah. So actually, it might be really interesting for people in Columbus to think about, like, why did we name the city what we did? It may have been an association only later put together. And that would be interesting to know.
Lisa, we're always looking for a new research project. But so then you go to Chicago, which has a huge Italian American community. They're really invested in that statue, right? They're having their own debates there. But here in St. Paul, that statue was, you know, put up by like 100 Italian Americans in the 1930s. We don't have a substantial Italian American population here that came down as part of the protests around George Floyd. It's still down. Actually, there was news this week that's interesting about it, that there is a commission that's going to study whether it goes back up. One of the people on that commission is our Lieutenant Governor Peggy Flanagan, who is a citizen of my tribe, tribal nation, White Ojibwe, and she says that's not going back up. So I don't know. I don't know where that will go, but that actually hit the news this week. Those are, I would, you know, those are going to be three very different conversations, and I can imagine really different outcomes.
Yeah, I mean, my that is such a good question, because my initial reaction is like, tear it down. But then, yeah, as Jeannie was saying, if we look at Chicago, might we be able to tell a story about immigrants gathering together and producing a symbol of pride in their own experience in America? It's different from the Statue of Liberty, right? So,
but what can it also somehow has to take into account the indigenous perspective as well, right? I mean, it has to.
Mm-hmm. I think it's an interesting opportunity to think about this, right? Immigration and indigenous history and how they're layered and intertwined.
And, you know, just to go back to Massasoit, there's, as far as I know, no conversation about taking that statue down. And it's a different kind of statue because it's a piece of fine art by a famous artist. Mm-hmm. And it's beautiful. And actually, we think that that plaque that they put up in the 90s does really good revisionary work. So, I mean, there's lots of different ways. Apparently, one of my colleagues who does Ming China said they took down all the Chiang Kai-shek's statues and put them in one museum. So there's lots of different potential solutions.
And then the Soviet park, what was it all? So Lenin Park, right? Where all the statues of Lenin are just gathered together.
Right, I'm so intrigued in that idea of the plaque as another layer, and how many layers can we actually add to a story, and what kind of a monument would that make, a multiple layered monument. I love that idea. Okay, let's do one more question and then we will close for the evening. This question comes from Ka, who's a historian at Holy Cross. And he writes, I was fascinated by the story you tell in the book of Cyrus Dallin's use of the African-American Thomas McKellar as the model for the Massasoit statue. That's my dog, sorry. McKellar's relationship with John Singer Sargent was the subject of a recent exhibit at the Gardner Museum.
Oh.
Stories like this have significance for generating further interest or solidarity around indigenous activism across non-white communities.
Yeah, well, that's a tough one. We thought of it as an interesting moment to think about the layers and directions of appropriation, and also the ways in which those who are represented might have some agency in ways that have not been granted to them in the past, right? So I was thinking of it in the context of Massasoit and how he represented himself and his leadership role with what he chose to wear. And that was then described by the English. So it's not an English description, it is a Massasoit, the Massasoit's choice that then gets sort of translated into the statue. For Thomas McKellar, we can't know exactly, but I do wonder, right, like how we might read his own interests, his own experiences, his own choices about how to be depicted. And it gets, I don't know, I'm still working through this. This is a really good question, right? Of how to create links today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was a tough one for us to kind of sort through. And also that what we heard from Wampanoag people was that the model was Wampanoag people, which we write about briefly. We didn't find documentation of it, but we wanted to acknowledge that that's the perspective. Yeah. So the possibility of multiple models is there as well. And if it, I mean, and if that's the case, then that's erased from the record, from the written record. And it would make sense that it would be part of it, of the process.
Well, I want to sincerely thank our speakers for joining us for this series. I think it's been really illuminating, and we so appreciate how you've connected and helped us make sense of what we've heard before in our series. Thank you for taking the time and telling us about your book. I hope that some of our participants will read the book. I'm excited to read it now that I have this great introduction. And yes, just thank you. And everyone have a lovely night. Feel free to reach out to myself or Professor Luria or Professor Doughton if you have questions, comments, want to learn more about the series. And we hope that you all have a great evening. Thank you so much.
I want to thank you, Sarah, and everybody involved in this event. This has been wonderful. I'm also really curious and love to see the packaging film.
Great.
If you can send a link at some point, I would love that. Thank you for having us.
Yes, thank you so much. It's been great.
Thank you all for listening.
Bye, everyone.